This segment, we're going to talk about genes and the term alleles. We have genes, and alleles are simply different versions of genes. So we're going to talk about the distinction between genes and alleles. Humans, for example, have about 23,000 genes or so throughout their genome. So here are some representations of a few different human chromosomes. So let's say that's human chromosomes 1, 2, and 3 in decreasing size. And the different chromosomes will have different genes on them. And often the positions of genes are denoted by an orthogonal or perpendicular mark. And I'll just say, here's a gene, gene A, the location of the gene on chromosome 1. And we might say that there's a gene B at this location on chromosome 2. There might be a gene called gene C on chromosome 3. And these genes are going to differ between different individuals. So we could blow up the sequence of gene A and just look again at a random DNA sequence, a short one. And here's gene A from, say, my mother. And my father is genetically different. He's a different individual. So if we look at gene A from my father, so that's maternal. I'm just going to use this notation, gene A from the paternal side, my father. He might have a single nucleotide polymorphism, a SNP, where my mother has a G at that location in gene A, my father has an A, for example. So we can have multiple genes in our genome. We do have multiple genes in our genome. And we can distinguish, again, using mutations like single nucleotide polymorphisms, we can distinguish one version of the gene from another. And remember, we're all diploid organisms, humans are, and so we each have two copies of each of these chromosomes in cells that are in interphase. And so we'll have two copies of gene A, two copies of gene B, and two copies of gene C. That is, two alleles, a maternal allele and a paternal allele. And the only way geneticists know which allele they're talking about is when the two different versions, alleles of the gene, have nucleotide sequence differences, like a G to A SNP. So if I redrew chromosome 1 in the same orientation, just making it a little bit larger, we could identify the maternal version that I inherited as containing a G. So we could say, here's gene A, and it's got the G allele, gene A, G allele. And the paternal version of that chromosome has gene A, but there's, instead of a G being present from the maternal allele, there's an A. So gene A, allele A. So now we're distinguishing the two versions of this gene that I have according to the nucleotide that's present that distinguishes the maternal and the paternal versions of this chromosome. And there isn't just going to be one single nucleotide polymorphism or mutation. It could be an indel as well on the chromosome, because each chromosome will have multiple genes. For example, we could now suggest that instead of being on three different chromosomes, genes B and C are on the same chromosome. And those genes might differ in different nucleotide ways. This might be a TC polymorphism in some place in gene B, and there could be an AT mutation in gene C. The point that I want to leave you with is that if you're a diploid organism, you can only have two different chromosomes. There are two different alleles of chromosome 1. You've got your maternal haplotype, which is another word for a chromosome-wide allele. We've got the maternal haplotype, that is, chromosome or gene A has a G in it, gene B has a T in it, and gene C has an A in it, and you have a paternal haplotype as well. There's another piece of terminology that I can add in here, and that is the difference between heterozygous and homozygous genotypes. So for gene A in this individual, one copy of the chromosome has a G at the same position on the gene, and the other copy of the chromosome has an A. This is defined as a heterozygous genotype. hetero meaning different or other, because there are two different nucleotides here. We could also look at the other type of genotype, which is homozygosity. And that would be, for example, this nucleotide here, which is also in gene A, so I'm going to write it in now. There's a C at a different part of gene A. Those are the same between the two different chromosomes. I can't use them, they're not useful, to distinguish the two chromosomes. These are homozygous. So the individual that these two chromosomes came from, one chromosome that this individual inherited from their mom, and one chromosome they inherited from their dad, they're heterozygous for a SNP, single nucleotide polymorphism, here in gene A. There's a G and an A, different, heterozygous. Most of the other nucleotides, you'll notice, are identical between the two chromosomes. I'm putting asterisks above them here. Those are all homozygous. Regardless of which chromosome you look at, you have the same nucleotide at that position in the gene. Some individuals are not diploid, have two copies of every chromosome, but some individuals have four copies of every chromosome. So here might be an individual, say nucleus, that has copies 1, 2, 3, and 4 of a chromosome. This is a single chromosome. Instead of being diploid and having two copies, they have four copies. And this is true, for example, in salmon. Classical example of an organism where they're naturally tetraploid, four copies of each chromosome. And we could imagine that there's a gene X here, and that there are nucleotide differences, SNPs, for example, that distinguish those four chromosomes. So there might be an A on one chromosome, a T at the same position on the next chromosome, a G there, C there, and a G there on the bottom. The question I'd like you to think about is, what is the largest number of alleles of a gene that any individual could have? So here we looked at two different alleles. Here we're looking at four. But I want to leave you with the impression that it's not the number of nucleotides that we have in our DNA, four, A, T, C, and G, that limit the number of copies of a gene or alleles that we can have. And here's an easy way to illustrate that. Let's also look at a gene called gene Y, and we'll look at a second individual. And it's four chromosomes. So it might have the same set of nucleotides on its four chromosomes at gene X, but it might have a different set on gene Y. So let's say these are the imaginary genotypes on gene Y. Okay. So here we have an individual that has a haplotype AT. The second chromosome has the haplotype TA. We have two C's together on one chromosome. We've got a G and a C. And note that if you look at just one of these genes, for example, in salmon number 2, you can't discriminate only if you're looking at gene Y. You can't discriminate between these two, the first and the second chromosomes, because they both have an A at that locus. But you can discriminate those chromosomes if you look at a different gene. So this individual has four distinct haplotypes, an AA, a TA, a GCG, and a GC, as does this individual. So these salmon have up to four haplotypes, or four different versions of their chromosomes, by virtue of the fact that they have four chromosomes. So in sum, we have individual chromosomes, and the genotypes, the letters, the nucleotides that they have along them, are considered a haplotype. So here's a maternal haplotype, a paternal haplotype. And diploids will have two haplotypes. Tetraploid organisms that have four copies of every chromosome would have four haplotypes. If you were octoploid and had eight copies of every chromosome, you could have eight different haplotypes of your chromosomes. And again, that's not limited by the number of nucleotides we have, A, T, G, and C. Because you can look at multiple loci across each chromosome to define a haplotype.